Hey everybody, welcome back to the Scalemodelmedic YouTube channel. In this video, I'm going to be doing some weathering on the Games Workshop Promethium relay pipes. This is a really nice set of wargaming scenery, and the box art does show it in a nice rusty finish. However, it's a little bit clean and very much in the style of the Games Workshop studio. I've decided to go down a different route and paint this with a technique that I came up with a few years ago. I haven't seen it done before or since, so I'm claiming it as my own technique. And the finish it gives is quite detailed with lots of small chips, and it allows you to quickly and easily build up a really nice rusty effect. I'm going to get started now in my usual fashion, and the models have already been coated with a good layer of Ultimate Black Primer. Over the top of this, I'm going to be using Humbrol's matte coat diluted with Humbrol enamel thinners to anchor in place a good layer of weathering powders. To keep the rust tone interesting and varied, I've used colours from different brands. Light Rust and Old Rust from MIG Pigments, and also Burnt Sienna and Burnt Umber from Vallejo's weathering range. These powders are glued firmly to the surface of the model using the matte coat mixture. And as you can see, when it's dry, it's perfectly safe to handle these models without transferring any of the rust colour to your fingers. To build up the random chipping effect, I'm going to be using Maskol, which is Humbrol's liquid masking solution, and I'm going to be applying it in small areas using a sponge. Over this, I'll then airbrush one of the greys from the Mr. Hobby Aqueous range to give the model its base colour. Let's begin by applying a small amount of the matte coat mixture to a small portion of the pipe. This is applied with an old brush, and I'm using quite a large one as well, as I want to cover the area quickly. While the varnish is still wet, grab a small amount of the weathering powder and start to tap it into the wet varnish. I can then select a different colour and tap that in as well and blend the two together while they're on the surface, so there's no need to mix any colours, it's all done on the actual model itself. By selecting the different tones, I can create high spots and low spots wherever I want, but it's important to note that I'm using a very small amount at a time, as I don't want to build up too much surface texture. The weathering powder has quite large granules in it, so I don't want to create too much roughness on the surface. When you've reached the end of that portion, simply apply a little bit more varnish and blend the two areas together, again using the same method, selecting a small amount of weathering powder and then tapping it into the wet varnish. After working my way across the model, I can go back and blend anything together which looks out of place, and the end result is an overall coating of the rust-coloured weathering powders. Because matte coat is an enamel varnish, it will chemically harden over the next 24 hours or so, and I want to get to it while it's still quite soft, so I've only allowed these to dry for about 15 minutes before moving on to the Maskol stage. To apply the Maskol, I'm using a sponge which has been ripped into a ragged pattern, and any high spots on the sponge have been torn away, as these will create large individual chips, which isn't the effect that I'm looking for. After prepping the sponge, I transfer a small amount of the Maskol to a piece of acetate, which means that I can test the chipping pattern before the sponge goes anywhere near the surface of my model. By picking up a small amount of the Maskol on the sponge and then tapping it on the acetate, I can get a kind of preview of what the chips are going to look like. The way this technique works is by using Maskol to protect the weathering powder from the base colour which is applied afterwards. Anywhere you see a small purple spot on this stage will be peeled away to reveal the weathering powder after the model has been painted. So anywhere you see the Maskol, you'll see rust when it's finished. Because these pipes are damaged, I'm applying quite a heavy layer of the Maskol to these ragged ends. And what this means is that as I tap more and more chips on, some of the areas might look the same. So I spin the sponge 180 degrees and then go and apply another set of chips over the top to blend it all together. Once this has been done on these damaged ends, I can go around the rest of the model and apply the Maskol to those areas as well. What I want to do is vary the amount of chips which is being applied. On the larger areas, on the underside of the pipes, I'll apply some of the heavier chips, but on the upper surface, I'll apply just a few small ones to break up the surface. Over the top of this, when the Maskol's dry, I'm going to airbrush grey FS16440 using my Infinity 2-in-1 airbrush to build up a base colour. The paint is thinned with Ultimate Airbrush thinners as always, and it's been airbrushed over the top of a recently applied enamel finish. Don't forget that that matte coat is still soft. This prevents the paint sitting as well as it would do if I'd airbrushed straight over the primer. So I need to build up light coats and allow them to dry in between just to ensure that I get good adhesion. The paint that I'm using is a gloss, and this is deliberate because it gives good contrast between the matte rusty finish underneath and the shiny paint on the top. With a couple of layers of paint settled down and dried, I can then go ahead and airbrush on a final solid layer of the gloss off-white paint to build myself up a really good solid base colour. I also have the option to leave a few areas slightly darker to enhance shadow or enhance contrast, but for the most part I just want to make sure that everything's covered and that there are no areas left unpainted. Now it's time to remove the mascol and reveal the chipping effect that I've built up. I'm using a nylon brush here with the bristles cut really short to make it really stiff. This is the quickest way of grabbing all the smaller pieces of mascol, but you do risk damaging the paint. An alternative is to use a small piece of adhesive putty, in this case this is white tack, but you could use blue tack, and that really grabs onto the mascol and helps to pull it away, and there's no risk to the paint. This is the satisfying portion of the process, and as you go around picking off the mascol, you start to reveal that weathering powder layer underneath, and you start to see the technique take shape. If you were one of those kids who used to like to peel the glue off your fingers at school, you'll love the fact that the heavily applied areas can be pulled away in nice big sheets, revealing the weathered finish that we've worked to build up with the sponge. After removing the mascol, we now have exposed areas of matte coat and weathering powder alongside areas of acrylic base coat. I can now reactivate the weathering powder using enamel thinners and spread it around, creating streaks and seeping rust effects. I was so happy with myself, I decided it was time for a drink. No, not really, I just need some enamel thinners to reactivate that matte coat mixture. Airbrush thinners and acrylic thinners won't work, it needs to be an enamel to key into that matte coat and get it going again. Using a small brush, I applied some of the Humbrol enamel thinners to one of the rust spots, and straight away you can see it bites into the varnish and allows those weathering powders to move, streaking down over the base coat. The reason that I think this technique is so convincing is because the weathering powders are anchored at the source on the rust chip. So this means it bleeds out from the place where it's supposed to rather than just being applied over the top. By giving the enamel thinners a couple of seconds to bite in, you can create a stronger streak, but it will always originate at the rust chip, so the streaks are quite convincing and you don't have to use any kind of special brush techniques to build up heavier colour near the source. By tapping the thinners on instead of streaking it, you can get it to bleed out over the base colour. This means that the two areas blend together and you get a more seeping rust effect rather than streaking and running. This is the important part when you're doing areas of heavy rust, as the paint itself gets discoloured. The streaks look good on the larger, flatter areas though, so make sure you do plenty of those, as rainwater or moisture would run downwards obviously and take the rust with it. This section of the model took about a good hour, as I worked around with a small brush, blending and carefully moving the weathering powders around, but it's important to note that you don't want to concentrate too heavily on one area. You do have a limited amount of powder anchored to the surface with the matte coat, and it will burn away eventually, revealing the black primer underneath. The real fun of this technique is that you can see a very good stark contrast between the base coat and the rust. You also get complete control, so if you spread it around too much, what you can't see off shot is that I'm actually cleaning the brush on some tissue and I can take some of the weathering powders away, meaning that I'm always in complete control of where the rust effect goes. Here's the end result of using the enamel thinners to spread the rust around. It's already starting to look convincing, but there are some areas which need a little bit more contrast, so I'm going to switch to a bit more of a traditional technique using Nuln Oil and Agrax Earthshade from the Citadel range to build up some areas of contrast and just enhance the detail in general. I'm going to keep on standby some water to make sure that I don't end up with tide marks. Starting with the Agrax Earthshade, I'm just pushing a little bit of the wash into this raised surface detail here, and then in the middle I'm taking some water, cleaning the brush on tissue and just blending away the tide mark to make sure that I'm not left with any ugly effects. While this area is still wet, I can make the most of the gloss finish of the paint and use it to create capillary action to pull the wash tight into the raised details. If we take a look up close, you'll see more what I mean. I'm applying quite a loose coat of the Agrax Earthshade in this corner, and then while it's still wet, using the gloss finish of the model to pull that wash tight. I'm left with an ugly mark, so a quick clean of the brush and I can start to blend this into the surface and take away that stark dividing line between the wash and the paint. By cleaning the brush on the tissue, I can then completely remove any wash I don't want to be there. Switching to the Nuln Oil now, I'm going to use this again with the water just to add some areas which are much darker. This will increase the contrast, but also on areas which are heavily rusted, you can't really see the Agrax Earthshade working, so this is an important step to make sure everything gets a nice shadow around it. The same technique is used, pushing the wash into the raised details and then cleaning away any tide marks. To add a little bit of visual interest, some areas were given a much heavier application of the Nuln Oil just to give them a darker appearance, and also in some of the recesses to give them a really stark, dark shadow in there to break everything up and make it look a little bit bigger. With the washes applied, I use Citadel's Pallid Witch Flesh, diluted with a little bit of water, just to create a highlight. You could dry brush this on, but I prefer to go around and apply it very sparingly, only in areas where either there's a high spot, or perhaps maybe some of the dirt might have been knocked away. The Imperial Eagles are of course highlighted, because as anybody who plays 40k knows, the Emperor's light always shines through. Some of the rivets are also tapped with the highlighted paint, just to make them stand out a little bit, and any edges which might have been caught and just had the dirt brushed off them. This is kind of an optional stage, and I only do it just to enhance a few of the little areas. I apply it very sparingly, and in some cases, a few dots on some of the flatter areas will enhance the surface finish. So there you go guys, there's the end result of my weathering powder and mask oil technique. I managed to get about 5 of these painted up for a game night, and when they were sat there on the terrain board, I was really happy with the results and the way that they came out. I hope this video has been nice and clear, not made it look too complicated, because it's a really fast and easy way to get nice convincing weathering results. I know I don't upload much these days people, but please subscribe and check back for more videos in the future, and I hope you've enjoyed watching and that the techniques got your interest. Thanks very much for watching, and I'll see you again next time.